Good day to all my fellow travelers, photographers, and friends around the world. Welcome to Chris Lee Travel Channels. This is my number 61 episode of my travelogue, and also the third and the last episode of my travel journey to Indonesia. Now, in today, I'm going to share with you a special regions in Central Java. It's known as Special Region of Yogyakarta. Here were housed some royal families of the Sultanates, and at the same time, I will bring you to another very interesting and very famous Hindu temples that's outside India, that is Candi Prambanan, as promised you in my last episode. So let's look at the Central Java map again. You notice that the arrow they're pointing to, this is the area that marked as special region of Yogyakarta, and which I'm going to bring you to this region in today's episode. So this is a closer view, right, of these special regions, and you notice that this the Candi Prambanan is right at the border between this special region and as well as the Central Java province of Indonesia. So let's begin our tour to this Candi Prambanan. Let's get some facts about this Candi Prambanan. Candi Prambanan is also known as Roro Jonggrat Temples. It's a 9th century Hindu temple complex in the special region of Yogyakarta on Java Islands, Indonesia. It's located 17 kilometers northeast of Yogyakarta city. The Hindu or Buddhist temple in Indonesia is termed Candi, just for those who only join me in this episode. Now, Candi Prambanan is being regarded as the masterpiece of Hindu culture of the 9th century and the biggest and the most beautiful Hindu temple complex in Indonesia and second largest in Southeast Asia after Angkor Wat in Cambodia. It's characterized by its tall and pointed architectures, a typical Hindu architecture style. This temple is also a UNESCO World Cultural Heritage Site since 1991. Now, just move a bit on further to understand this place better. And you can see the showing the map again is actually with the aim to show you the location of this Candi Prambanan. And this Candi Prambanan is actually located in an archaeological site, and it was termed as Taman Wisata, right? Now, of course, in this Taman Wisata, it housed more than one temple site, and Candi Prambanan is one of them, and is the major one. And this is a tourist map, and you look closely that the square at the center of this map, this is actually the location of Candi Prambanan. And let's look at this, the layout plan of Candi Prambanan. You'll notice that there are many tiny square. Some of them, of course, you have a largest one at the center. These are all temple complex. Now, this temple complex originally housed 240 temple structures, which represent the grandeur of Java, Hindu art and architectures. The 240 temples were made up of three Trimurti temples, which also the main temples, which house the god of creator, the Brahma, the god of preserver, which actually as is called Vishnu, and god of destroyer, Shiva. Then they have another three slightly smaller temple, is called Vahana temple, which house three other gods, basically the god of Garuda, the god of Nadi, and also the god of Hamsa. Then you have two upit temples, both at the north and the south locations. Then four Kelia temple plus four Patok temple, which is located at all the four sides of this temple complex. Then the remaining 224 tiny temple structures are termed Purvara temples, which distributed uniformly at the outer region of this temple complex or compound. And the three main temple or shrine are the Brahma temples in the north, the Vishnu temple in the south, and in between this Brahma and Vishnu temple locate the largest and the tallest Shiva temple. The temple structure, the Shiva temple structures towering a total of 47 meters into the air. Now this archaeological site is open to the public as early as 5 a.m. in the morning and closed well after nightfall. It's recommended to visit this archaeological site in the early morning if you wish to capture the sunrise, as well as late evening if you wish to capture the sunset. And the best season to travel recommended is between the month of May till September, which is the dry season in Indonesia. So the map here have clearly shown the major temple in this temple complex. And this is a sign at the entrance to this archaeological site. This is an aerial views. And you can notice that there's those small, much smaller, the smallest temples, right, which I mentioned, 224 number of them, most of them have been destroyed. And you can, from this site, you can find that only a few of them have been reconstructed. So in this image, the right nearest to you is the main temple, and then the next is the next also major temple, but house the god of Brahma. The center one just now is the god of Shiva. So these are the closer view of this temple Shiva. And for 47 meter in height, it translates to approximately 15 story high building if you're taking every 3 meter as a one story high. And of course, at the stairway, the leading to the main temple, you can always find some stone carving or stone statue of animal of that kind. One of the entrance gate to the main temple. closer view of the creature, the stone statue at the stairway. Some of the relief panels found in this temple site on the main temple building. And it's important to note that this temple is ranked second in the world after Angkor Wat in terms of Hindu temple. And this is one of the elephant god statue. More carvings on the face of the temple. And then the next stop, I'm going to bring you to the Sultan Palace. Now, Sultan Palace are given the name Kraton Yogyakarta Hadiningrat, right? And it's a wooden palace, wooden palace complex in the city of Yogyakarta, of Yogyakarta Special Regions of Indonesia. Now in Indonesia, the Kraton mean palace. Now this wooden palace complex was built in the year 1755 till 1756, about 2 years duration for the first Sultan of Yogyakarta. That is the Sultan Hamengkubuwono the first, which actually is that at this period the Yogyakarta exists as a state. Now the complex consists of a courtyard, a fairly large courtyard, and ornamented main buildings, and a secondary building with simple ornamentations. Now currently, this complex is a center of Javanese culture and contains a museum displaying the royal artifacts and are guarded by the Yogyakarta Kraton Guard or the Royal Guard. All buildings in this complex were built in traditional Javanese architectural style, decorated with flora, fauna, and all natural motifs. Now, over time, right, with the extension and renovations taken place, the foreign influences from Portuguese, Dutch, and Chinese can be found, right, on this architecture's building, on this building of this palace. So this is the main entrance to this palace. And these are some of the main buildings found in this palace compound. From the look, you can distinct that is actually they are built, and over time, it's quite different in terms of the facade look. You can find one open air type of semi open without wall type of building in this palace complex. And quite a number of these small little sheds. The one of these main building sections, you notice that, as you can see in this image, It did not have any perimeter wall, but it extended quite far out. And in here, you can find house quite a numbers of those ancient traditional musical instruments. It's believed it's the place that where the Sultanate that welcome their guests, and it's where here that whole musical performance to entertain his guests. The building structure here a bit unique and outstanding. These buildings use also quite a fair bit of wrought irons, form of decorated wrought irons. Some of the royal, this is one of the royal sign in this palace. Among the so many roof ceiling that we found, this is the one of the most extravagant and the most unbelievable beautiful ceiling in this palace. This is actually the sign right above the ceiling. And this is decoration at the foot of the major columns of this building. The railings is also high, well decorated. This wrought iron grating is fascinating. And this palace also kept guardians that you can find in most of the Candi in the Buddhist temple. One of the wax figures in this at the entrance to this palace complex. Chandelier. The beautifully decorated compound lighting, the poles and the lanterns, and these are some of the royal sign found in this palace complex. Now, I need to mention here that in this palace complex itself, it house a museum, right? So it is important that when you visit this palace complex, do not miss the museum sections. This another building that's I found very interesting, and is where some of the expensive artifacts were kept, or rather is keeping in these buildings. This is what the artifact have been displayed in the museum. Some of the collections of porcelain plates. And the picture of the various sultans. Some of the porcelains figure or statue. Believed to be a gift given by the foreigner guests. Then we also visit this Taman Sari. Now, Taman Sari is also known as the Water Castle, the Royal Water Castle. Now, this Taman Sari Royal Pool or Water Castle was built between 1755 to till 1992, stretched over a long period of time. In other words, there are many constructions that taken place from time to time. It's a building complex, right, with 57 buildings as well as a historical site in Yogyakarta. It was one the bath of the Sultan family, right? Its primary function here was to serve as a place of rest for mediate works, and as well as to hide and defend against the enemy attack. And for this reason, you will find some of the building walls are constructed quite solidly to serve this purpose. Now, the main attractions of this Taman Sari is, of course, the building complex, which rich in architecture styles of a combination of influences from Hindu, Buddhist, Javanese, Islam, Chinese, Portuguese, and Europeans. Now, entrance for visitor is via the Eastern Gate, also known as the Gapuro Panggung, which lead you right into the bathing pool area. So in this image now you see is the bathing pool area. This route leading to this the Taman Sari. This the buildings, the small this some of the small building that at the entrance, the Eastern Gate entrance area. And this is the main entry point to the bathing pool area. The leading step down, and it is inside the view of the pool. Now, it's important to understand that this bathing complex was divided into three zones. That the first zone is called Umbo Kavitan, is for the Sultan's daughter and son. And the second zone is called the Umbo Pamucha, is for the Sultan's consort. Alright, and the last zone is called Umbo Banguras, is for the Sultan himself. So there are also other places of interest between this complex, because they have 57 buildings. And I will recommend that you should include the visit the underground tunnel as well as the mosque between this building complex. So this is the views around the pool area. From this point, you will exit from the pool area to the other zone of the complex. They will house the other 56 buildings. This is one of the very interesting piece of building facade. You look at the motif that appear on the facade. And I'm going to bring you a piece of surprise in this episode, which I'm going to bring you to a jeep adventure to the Mount Merapi. Now, Mount Merapi or Gunung Merapi is one of the volcanoes and has the highest volcano peak in these regions. It's located on the border between the province of Central Java and the special region of Yogyakarta, as I showed you earlier in the maps. Now, the surrounding area include the Mount Merapi is now classified under the Mount Merapi National Park. In other words, a certain section in this region have been now classified as national park under protection. Now, the volcano is only 28 kilometers away from the Yogyakarta city. It's very near to the urban area. In Indonesia language, Gunung Merapi will means mountain of fire. You will be surprised why they're given this name. Because this volcano is the most active volcano in Indonesia. And within the span of 472 years till the year 2020, it has erupted 68 times. And the most recent major eruptions, right, is in the year 2010 in the month of October, which claimed 273 lives. Now, during these eruptions, right, it have completely destroyed several villages nearby. And one of the completely destroyed village were then turned into a tourist destination, a village museum. And it's where today, and now, I'm going to bring you on this jeep tour to visit this completely destroyed village by the eruption of Mount Merapi. And we have only 6 persons, so we booked 2 jeeps and to bring us in route into this village, which now turned museum. The almighty powers of the nature is now fully exhibited in these images that I'm going to share with you. So we are taking the long route, and you can see that there are two choices. Of course, we have to take the foreign tourists, we have to visit the yellow section, the itinerary listed on the yellow section. We are now on the jeeps en route to this destroyed village. When you cross, go close to the village, you can see the surrounding was a sign of being seriously destroyed and damaged by the eruption of the volcano. Not much tree around. This is my travel mates. And these clocks that show the time the eruption took place. And apparently, the date here is 5th of November 2010. This is one of the rock projectile from the volcano landed in this spot. The remain of the damaged village building, although there's an underground bunker to safeguard the life, but unfortunately it could only save life, but still have 273 lives been claimed by these eruptions. And of course the village buildings cannot be avoided and completely destroyed. The skeletons of remain of animals, in this case is buffalo. The furniture of the village home. This condition of the wall of the village home. Some are left behind, well burned, completely burned down, a motorcycle. Some of the remains of the buildings. So this end of my this number 61 episode of my travelogues, and also the last episode to Indonesia, the special region of Yogyakarta. In the coming episodes, it will definitely a new nation. And it's for once I'm going to share with you an ultra modern nations, and not far from Malaysia, and this nation is Japan. And for the first episode, I will share with you the capital city of Japan, Tokyo, ultra-modern metropolitans. And please stay tuned until we see you next week. And if you have stayed with me until this hour, I believe that you have been entertained. Please subscribe and share and promote my travel channels to your friends and family. And a thumb up from you is very important to me. At the same time, I wish you good health. Stay strong, stay strong, stay safe. Until we see you next week. And bye.